Okay, so people online can hear me. In case you see, for every problem you signal it on the chat or you intervene directly. Okay, let's start with this introduction to TBFT. And this is the outline. So after a brief motivation, I'm going to introduce the fundamental equation of time dependent density functional theory. But in particular, this lecture is on linear response TBFT. We are going to see also some second or third order response in lecture on Friday.
No, Claudio is on Friday.
Yeah. Okay, and Valerie maybe is going to talk about second order. Okay. And in particular, we are focusing on an implementation of TDFT, which is in frequency reciprocal space and on a plane wave basis set, which is the actual implementation of PPP code that you are going to use in the tutorial that some results. And finally, of this presentation, we are going to present, let's say, the results that you can obtain by doing the TDFT calculation using different approximations on our systems. So from 3D to 0D and 2D and so on. Okay, so about the motivation, I would like to, this has been already anticipated in the TFT calculation. All the theories that you are going to study in this school, in fact, represent a solution of a very important, formidable problem, which is the many body problem of condensed matter theory. In fact, in condensed matter theory, everything is perfectly clear. So, for example, the interaction between the constituents of the of matter, being them, nuclei, so electrons, and so on, are well known. It's the electromagnetic interaction, like, for example, in QMD. And so, our ignorance in condensed matter is only as in particular, fundamentally roots into this so-called many-body problem, a problem on how to deal the main interaction between all these constituents of condensed matter. And in fact, let's say this is well known since the beginning of quantum mechanics. In fact, it was very immediately clear that we can solve the Schrödinger equation only in a very simple case, the hydrogen atom, while in the case of helium atom, where you have already two electrons, the Schrödinger equation for this Hamiltonian containing this term, the many-body term, presents an important problem. And in fact, the many body problem was already a problem in classical physics. I remind you the free body problem in Newtonian physics that have, let's say, partial solution, but not the full solution. In quantum mechanics, the many body problem arises already at the level of two bodies. Quantum mechanics, I mean, two bodies means the two electrons, since we consider in our approach, say the more straightforward approach, the nuclei as a classical source of field. Okay. And the many body problem, let's say the problem for the many body problem is, as I told, and also as Gianmarco in the DFT introduction already explained, is due to the presence of these many body electron-electron interaction. And to the fact that you have to solve a Schrödinger equation for a wave function that, as you can see, contains as many variables, space variables, as the electrons of the system. So this number can be up to the Avogadro number. And so you see that the problem is cannot be even treated on a paper because these are huge functions. And in fact, if you neglect this term, there is not anymore many body problem, because as you can see, the Hamiltonian is factorizable. You can write the total Hamiltonian cap H as the sum of n small h Hamiltonian for each electron, and then you can solve the Schrödinger equation for the single electron, for the single particle equation. This is a solvable Schrödinger equation, like for the hydrogen atom. And then the solution for the many body problem is represented. The ground state total energy is the sum over all the energies of the single electrons. Of course, since these are fermions, you have to fill. You know that you have to fill by respecting the Pauli principle. So you can put only one electron per state, including spin. And then the many body wave function is the direct product of the single particle wave function of the single particle Schrödinger equation. Now the first theories to attack this problem, let's say the first way to the physicists at a certain point when they were in front of this problem decided to tackle this problem following two main approaches. From one side, there were people that said that the problem is too complex, cannot be solved microscopically, and so they decided to simplify the problem. And instead of studying the reality, they decided to introduce models, simple models, for which they can find an analytical solution of the Schrödinger equation. So, in the hope that the model could be still representative of the physical real situation. And here you have some, let's say, of the most important models introduced in physics. I also would like to say the Gellio model, the homogeneous electron gas model, is also a model. Then we have the Anderson model, the Hubbard model, and so on. In fact, after a certain time, we realized that some of these models, for example, the Hubbard model, has solutions just only in particular cases. So, for example, in 1D, there is no exact solution, analytical exact solution of the Hubbard model in 3D. So, this, at a certain point, also model physicists were obliged to find. Numerical solution for these models. And for example, dynamical nifty theory is a way to have a numerical solution to the Hubbard model in 3D. Okay. Before to quit this part, I would like to say that all these models have adjustable parameters inside. So you, let's say, you have to adjust these parameters, trying to reproduce as much as possible the situation. And every model, in a way, is a conjecture about the physical reality. So with a model, you decide that a certain physics is more important than another physics. And you try to, let's say, to take on, to focus on just only on this physics, forgetting the other physics that may be at the same order of the physics. And when you adjust the parameters, you maybe mask the important physics. Adjusting the parameters, you can exaggerate the part that the physics you think is more important, and you, let's say, you hide another part which can be relevant, so that at the end the interpretation you provide with your models can be wrong, can be not appropriate, not describing the real situation. Almost at the same time, there were another bunch of physicists that decided that the the analytical solution was impossible for real system, and they decided to search for a numerical solution of anyway an Hamiltonian that was still representative of the real situation. At the beginning, let's say they tried also to integrate some degrees of freedom. So for example, by doing some semi-empirical approach, some semi-empirical approach of, for example, time binding in solid state physics or linear combination of atomic orbitals in chemistry. But then with the increase in computing power, they realized it was possible to take into account all the degrees, all the macroscopic degrees of freedom. And so it was possible to go towards the so-called ab initio first principles, many body approaches. And here I list, let's say, a list of some of these ab initio first principle many body approaches. I insisted that all these theories are approaches to solve the many body problem. So in particular, not only quantum chemistry approach, configuration interaction, couple cluster, QMC, but also density functional theory. Density functional theory is a many body theory, a theory with a purpose to solve the many body problem of the ground state. So if everybody comes out and tell you that DFT is not many body theory, this is wrong. And the same for TDFT, which I'm going to introduce in this lecture, which is, let's say, an extension of DFT to account not only for the ground state, but also for excited states. And finally, the many body theories that are going to be introduced tomorrow and on Thursday. Okay, so.
Question. So, compared to this model that you're talking about,
yeah,
are close to forces that we have in molecular dynamics, or or not? These are not related to those forces.
No, they can be. Let's say you can use also this model to, for example, to do molecular dynamics, but are related. I mean, these models are, for example, the Abban model is a model
of the electronic structure.
Yes, the electronic structure. You can use also, you can do a molecular dynamics based on Abban model, for example. So let's say considering the Abban model as for the electronic structure of your system. But I mean, these are focusing mainly on the electronic structure.
And ab initio is equal to first principles, or is different?
Sorry?
Ab initio,
mm-hmm.
The term is equal to first principles.
Yes, yes. Let's say another way in subnuclear physics, they call this approach a microscopic approach. So, meaning that you are considering a microscopic Hamiltonian with all the degrees of freedom. Ab initio first principle is almost.
Sometimes the chemists would complain that it's not exactly the same.
So sometimes chemists say that ab initio refer just on configuration interaction or maybe other approaches. The list that Gianmarco presented yesterday, and DFT is not an ab initio approach. But in fact, if you pure DFT, let's say pure DFT, which you do not introduce, there are some functionals where you introduce plenty of adjustable parameters. But there are, for example, in LDA, chemists agree that that the DFT in LDA is an ab initio theory, at least on the. So, Francesco, I'm blocked. Ah, no, okay, I'm locked with this, so probably it's the battery, which is over. Okay. So introducing this to Fila of the physics zoology, and why ab initio theories, first principle ab initio theories are important, because because you, let's say, it is important to understand and explain observed phenomena without conjectures, which means, as I told you, that, let's say, you are not misinterpreting the reality by a model that is over-describing by adjusting a parameter, some physics which is not relevant. And it is important also to offer experimentalist reference data. This is exactly what Simon told you during the first day. We, let's say, before to do an experiment or to analyze our data, we need a theoretical modelization, a theoretical conjecture about our data, so reference data for them. And finally, only first principle, ab initio theories, can predict properties before the synthesis, the experiment, can anticipate the experiment, because in models, of course, you never know how to adjust these the parameters of the model, okay? And these are the purposes of our theoretical network, the European Theoretical Spectroscopy Facility. So we focus on these theories. Now, which ab initio theory for which properties spectroscopy? We had to, let's say, in order to, you're going to be shown a lot of theories, DFT, TDFT, GW, and so on, in order to orient yourself, which is the most suitable, which theory to use for which properties in spectroscopy, you can divide properties of matter in electronics, ground state properties, for example, the total energy, the atomic structure, the phase stability, and so on, electron density, even phonons, because from the point of view of the electronic degrees of freedom, phonons is a ground state properties. And in the other side, you can put electronic excited state properties, and among them, the electronic structure, which means the band plot, the band gap in solids, or the homolumo gap in molecules. And so the metal insulator character, which is related to the band gap system. Finally, also all the spectroscopy, so optical properties, optical spectroscopy, dielectric properties spectroscopy, quantum transport, and also electron phonon and superconductivity is an electronic excited state properties. And when you divide properties of matters into this two sector, you know that DFT is a good, in principle exact theory to solve the many body problem for the electronic ground state properties. So by DFT, you can calculate and predict all these properties. So the list I presented before. But then, let's say, since in DFT you are obliged to do approximation, the approximation for the exchange correlation function, you predict these properties with an error due to the function LDA, DB. And the normal error is 1-2% in the 99% of the condensed matter system. And this means, so these are all ground state problems, this means that DFT should work, exact DFT work, can predict this quantity even for strongly correlated systems. So when somebody comes out and tell you, no, DFT is not for exact DFT, is an in principle exact theory to predict the atomic structure, the total energy, also in ground, in strongly correlated system. And here you have a demonstration of this. So first, a simple system, which is helium atom, so only two body system. And here you see a table with the ground state total energy. I present several approximations. So from the non-interacting case, you neglect completely the many body interaction, and you see the energy is that one of nitrogen atom with Z equal 2 with two electrons is -4. Okay, Then you can go to the Hartree approach, Marco already introduced you, and this is the energy, the total energy you get in Hartree, in the Hartree approach, the Hartree Fock approach, and so on. Here you see the exact, in the helium atom, there is an exact solution. It is the only system where you can solve the Schrödinger equation with the accuracy you wish. You have a numerical accurate to all let's say the digit you wish, and you can compare this exact solution, for example, with the exact TFT, which in this system is possible, because in this system it was possible. Umbrigar and Gons calculated the exact exchange correlation potential of the theory. By this exact exchange correlation potential of the theory, you can recalculate the ground state energy, and you compare with exact, and you see that exact DFT exists and provide the exact answer of a many body problem. Okay, then you can compare also the DFT LDA total energy. Here you see with respect to the exact, and there, for example, the GGA PB. You see that the DFT LDA presented 2% error. It's a standard error of LDA, and GGA allows to reduce this error to less than 1%. Okay, and then you can compare also the, for example, the EXAT with all the other approaches, quantum Monte Carlo, the variational Monte Carlo approach, the diffusion Monte Carlo, and so on. And you can compare also with the full CI, which many say, ah, this is the EXAT approach. You see that here we did a calculation with the most pushed basis set, double augmented quintuple Z correlation consistent basis set, doing basis set, and you see that okay, you are correct up to the third digit, but you miss the fourth. Okay, and then you can compare also. Sorry, there is for people not online, there is a problem.
You didn't hit them across.
I can keep it out. Okay. Oh, no.
You can't.
What?
It's weird.
You.
Yeah, it's F. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
No.
No, I know. No, the cross is.
No, what you can do probably is that you can move it around. You can.
Okay, this is an advantage for people online. Okay. So you can see here the calculation of the lattice parameter in vanadium dioxide, which is considered since the beginning. Neville Mott said that this should be a strongly correlated system. You can see that the DFT LDA calculation with semi-core or with non-linear core correction is in a good agreement with the experiment. This, let's say we have an error, which is the T of LDA.
May I ask about what is exact DFT? That means?
Okay, exact DFT in this case. So you can go and check this work. Let's say they were able on the since in you can in this system you can do for you can calculate the wave function in an exact way. So you have the exact wave function of the system, which is a two-body wave function, a function depending of R1 and R2, the two electrons. You can calculate the density of the helium system, and this is the exact density, exact like this. Okay. And then you can invert the Kohn-Sham equation. You have the density. You can invert the Kohn-Sham equation to get the exact exchange correlation potential. It's a reverse engineering.
Oh.
So you do reverse engineering, you know the exact ground state density. And by this information, you can calculate the exact exchange correlation potential. Then you can take this exact exchange correlation potential, solve Schrödinger equation up to self-consistency, and you get this result. And you can compare also the exact exchange correlation functional shape, not here, but it's presented in the work, with the LDA and GGA, and see which potential is closer to the exact. And you will see that the LDA, GGA is more in agreement with the experiment, but the LDA, the sense correlation potential, is more in agreement with the exact than the PBE. The PBE presents some physical oscillations features. Okay. So, but what are the properties that DFT cannot predict? As I told, DFT is a ground state theory, and so all excited state properties, DFT is not in principle excited theory.
Can I come back
to the other slide?
Why didn't you show potential energy for V equal to? Because you don't have the total energy. Total energy for V equal to.
For V for two. Okay. Okay. It's present in the publication. I decided to present just solid lattice parameters. But I mean, in because in solid state the zero of the energy is not defined. So you know, in solids you don't have an infinity. In isolated system, the zero of the energy is the energy of, for example, of the dissociated atoms. So the energy at infinity.
Okay, well, total energy. If
of vanadium dioxide.
Yeah, the FT can predict the total energy up to this zero in for strong equilibrium system.
Yeah, but with which you compare? Because in helium, yes, exactly. Okay. So in helium, this energy is the energy you have to pay to explode the helium atom system.
So you are not sure if DFT works well for solid waste. I mean, for total energy.
Have you ever, for example, have you ever compared with the total energy, experimental total energy calculation not only of DFT, but also the gamma-infinity? As I told, let's say, the total energy in this system is okay. If you do a junction, for example, then you have a definition, it's a relative definition of the total energy of the two systems. But for a system which is bounded inside the solid filling space up to infinity, the zero of the energy is not defined. Also, when you calculate the band plot of a system,
yeah, you have only energy differences.
You have only energy differences. So in this case, I can produce you the number, but it's meaningless because since the zero of the energy is not defined, so you can on the solid state system you can produce a total energy curve as a function of for example of a lattice parameter. So for example, in case of silicon, you can produce a total energy which is a parabola. And this you can measure, you can compare somehow with experimental measures, in particular with phonons, because phonons are an indication of the curvature of this curve, the oscillation on the. And then, so you, as a function of a parameter, this is something, a quantity that you can compare. Total energy is meaningful in absolute values only for a finite system, because in this case, it is the energy to bring all the two electrons of helium up to infinity. So in order to ionize, explode the system completely, you have to pay minus the 2.90 R3. Okay, so to resume, you can't, DFT cannot predict these quantities. And these also in the case of exact DFT. So imagine that God suggests you during the night the exact form of the exact functional of DFT, for example, in helium, like in Umbrigar and Gons. You can calculate, for example, the Omolumo gap of the helium atom. And by exact DFT, you get 20.3 electron volt that you can compare with experimental, which is larger than 24.6. So you see that even exact DFT is unable to produce an excited state properties like the Omolumo gap. And if you do this calculation using DFT LDA, you observe the usual 40% underestimation of the experimental band gap Omolumo gap. Okay? Now, which ab initio theory for which excited state properties spectroscopy, you have to divide, let's say you have to split excitations into two kind of excitations, so-called charged excitations, in which you change the number of the charge of the system. You charge the system by adding one electron. So you pass from a system of n electron to a system of n plus one, or n minus one in the case of inverse Fourier emission, and neutral excitations in which the system does not undergo a change in the charge. So for example, an optical transition as measured, for example, in optical absorption or also in directive properties. And why we have to do this separation? Because in order to describe charged excitation, it is enough to take into account electron-electron interaction, while in the case of neutral excitation, there is a farther interaction that you have to take into account, the electron-hole interaction with the hole which is left behind your excitation. And in fact, TDFT is in principle exact theory, so a possible ab initio theory for the excited state, but just only neutral excitation spectroscopy. So just only I will list them. While in order to reproduce, for example, photoemission, inverse photoemission, you should move to many body perturbation theory, in particular the GW approximation, while Bethe-Salpeter is an equally valid approach to describe neutral excitation like TDE. Okay? And so these neutral excitation spectroscopy are, for example, optical properties. They have been introduced by Simon in the first presentation. So optical absorption, the diffraction index, and the reflectance. And also dielectric properties, so the energy loss, or the inelastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy. You change the primary electrons and X-rays instead of electrons. And so you can, by TDFT, calculate all the spectra. We are going to see what are the results you can obtain by TDFT in the last part. All right, now let me, so the break is at,
another 15 minutes.
Okay, another 15 minutes. So let me introduce this theory. And what is TDFT? TDFT is an extension of static DFT. It is a DFT with a time-dependent external potential. So at the basis of DFT, you have seen there is this Hohenberg-Kohn theorem, which states that the electron density and the static ionic potential are bionivocally related. Okay, in TDFT, let's say the central to TDFT is the Runge-Kraus theorem, which is an extension of the Hohenberg-Kohn theorem to the case of time dependence. So it states that the time dependent electronic density is a one to one correspondence to the external dynamic potential. So this potential now hosts not only the static ionic potential, but also an external time dependent perturbation, for example, an electromagnetic field. Okay? So the fundamental degree of freedom of time dependent electron. Of TDFT is the time-dependent electron density instead of the total many-body wave function. Okay, so like in DFT, the only difference is that you have a dependence on T. The milestones of this theory are the Runge-Kraus theorem, set up the rigorous basis of TDFT, and then the Gross and Kohn paper of 85. Provided basis of TDFT in linear response. Hello. Now I'm going to not to demonstrate this theorem, but to give you an idea of, let's say, the way to demonstrate it. And in fact, it is like the Hoiberg-Cohn theorem. It is demonstrated by reductio ad absurdum proof, which means that you imagine two different electronic systems. In which you have the same number of electrons, so the kinetic term of the Hamiltonian is the same, the mass of the electron, every electron has the same mass no matter the system, and also the interaction between the electron is the same Coulomb interaction no matter the system. What is making the difference between the two systems is just only the external potential, the external ionic potential. So for example, in one case, you can have the external potential for a helium atom. In another case, you have the external potential of a hydrogen ion. So two protons split or in the same point makes two different potential. And this means that the two systems. So if you, let's say, the Runge-Kraus theorem prove this statement that if you have two systems in which the external potential is different by more than a mere time-dependent constant, then the density evolution of the two systems are necessarily, even if you start from the same density, so for example in helium and the hydrogen molecule, you force the density to be at the same point, have the same configuration, the same pattern, spatial pattern, then in the two systems, the fact that you have two different external potential, you follow two different evolution for the density. Thanks to this theorem, this means that this relation is biunivocal, and so it means that any observable is a function of the time-dependent density. Any observable that in quantum mechanics you have to calculate by this Brian-Katt formula for an operator, but you can find the functional expression for this operator, so the dependence of the observable as a function of the density, time-dependent density, and have you can calculate this quantity by this approach. And okay, now we have to mention that all these formal aspects have some caveats. Okay, I'm not going to enter into these problems. However, they are described in the notes I have provided you. So, and there are the references where you can go in deep into this problem. The only point I would like to mention is the fact that the Runge-Kraus theorem is a little bit different with respect to the Hoiberg-Cohn theorem. In the Hoiberg-Cohn theorem, this relation is the relation between the density and the potential can write them exactly like this. While in the case of the Runge-Kraus theorem, it is not true that any observable is functional of the density alone, but also the initial state. So in practice, you have a complication here. You have to do, and this is a many body wave function, not density. However, of course, you can, for example, specify this initial state because in time dependent density functional theory, you have a time dependent problem. So you have differential equation in which the time appears as a degree of freedom. And so you need a boundary condition. And the boundary condition is to specify the system at a time t zero, okay? And so you can specify the system at time t zero as being in the ground state. But then also there is another caveat, another problem in the Runge-Kraus theorem. The Runge-Kraus theorem is proven only under the requirement that V of t is expanded around t zero. So you have a Taylor expansion of V of t at t well zero. And this is not compatible with the fact to have the ground state, because in order to have the ground state, you have to wait for enough long time to put the system in the ground state, so a situation like this. And then at t equals zero, you switch on the interaction, your electromagnetic field. But you see that V of t is not, cannot be expanded. It's not ever expandable around this point. Like also, you cannot expand around this point, because in this point, you have a discontinuity of the first derivative. Here, the function is discontinuous already. Here, the first derivative, so there is no Taylor expansion. However, so in practice, however, let's say the Runge-Grosse theorem has been proven in a lot of other cases. A lot of other cases have been explored, and so although there is no general proof of the Runge-Grosse theorem in general, however, you can assume that the Runge-Grosse theorem has a validity which is much beyond what is actually demonstrated. Okay, so however, these are formal problems. You can you may decide not to care and go on with the standard VFT. Then, okay, I would like to introduce the DFT by doing a zoological comparative anatomy with respect to DFT that you may know better. And so, as we told, the central to the two theories, these two theories, the Hoyer-Mercone and the Runge-Grosse. Then, thanks to this theory, every observable can be a function of the density. And in particular, the most important observable are the total energy for DFT and the action for TDFT. Of course, you introduce these time degrees of freedom. And so in DFT and in TDFT, the total energy and the action are unique functionals of the density. And then also in both theory, you have a minimum principle, the extrema of the total energy in one case and the stationary point of the actions give the exact density of the system. So in practice, by, let's say, by doing the functional derivatives of the functional, you can find the point, the extrema or the stationary points of your problem, thus finding the exact density and the exact time-dependent density in TDFT. Okay, this is one way you can follow. So for example, there are some applications which exactly use this approach. But another approach that you can follow is, like in DFT, introducing a fictitious auxiliary called sham system. A non-interactive fictitious system under the requirement that it provides, so for a non-interactive system, but that provides the exact density of the real interactive system. So this is the hypothesis of Consham, the Consham fictitious system. And you can do the same also TDFT. Solve the problem of DFT and TDFT by introducing this fictitious system, by solving the so-called Consham equations, which are static in the case of DFT. So you solve the static Schrödinger equation in the case of DFT. You solve the dynamic, the time-dependent Schrödinger equation in the case of TDFT. Okay. And then also continue on the analogy, the Consham potential is provided by this expression EFT. Here is the external potential, the RT potential, the exchange correlation potential. In TDFT is the same. The only difference is that to calculate the exchange correlation potential, you have is defined as the functional derivative of the action instead of the energy. See here, okay? However, the situation is similar, so it means that using the auxiliary Consham system, you can calculate by solving a single particle Consham equations, you can calculate the density evolution respect to a certain Consham potential with the interaction of the electrons switched to zero, so non-interactive electrons, problems which is solvable, exactly like the Kohn-Chomsky problem is solvable in DFT. But then you have, after this calculation, you have the density, the Kohn-Chomsky density, which by construction is corresponds, is identical to the density of the real system with the complex electron interaction on. Okay?
Can you go back to your previous
slide? I just joined you.
My question is about this action and the way that it was defined in the previous slide. The action.
No, I, okay.
Because
I defined the, yes, the action is defined in the previous slide, but this is the total action.
But it looks like if the, if it's really inside is the exact solution of the Schrodinger equation, that integral looks like being zero.
No, I'm looking for the point. No, you have to distinguish between just a moment. So you have to distinguish between AXC and the total action. Here there is only AXC, not the total action. Okay. Yeah, and the and for the total action, I still not that given an expression. Like I have not given an expression for the excess correlation energy of DFT. This depends on the approximation we are using, the functional. Okay. Nevertheless, these two quantities are different. So the total action is, that I brought here, that for which I search for the stationary point, which are not necessarily the stationary point of the excess correlation, it's the total action here. The total action comprises other terms that I'm not writing here. The other term are the R3 action and external action. Okay. Okay, so again, very briefly, I mentioned other further caveats of TDFT. If you, let's say, if you want to solve the problem of TDFT by searching the stationary point, of this functional, okay, it's gone. of this functional, then you run into another problem, which is exactly analogous of the problem of TFT, that the functional is defined only for V representable density. So densities which are the, let's say, not no matter which functions, but represent the density of a real system. So it means that they have to correspond to some physical potential V. And if you introduce a functional, no matter the functional, you can have problems when you are looking for variation of A with respect to arbitrary density, not physical densities. However, this problem has been solved also, like in DFT, referring to the work of Levy. So in the notes, I also point to you other the solution that have been found to this problem. Another problem is the so-called causal symmetry paradox. In fact, you can see that if this functional derivative exists, then we can transform, we can define the Legendre transform of the action, here defined, the Legendre transform of the action. And by definition, the functional derivative of the Legendre transform of the action, which is a functional of V, not of rho, with respect to V, provides the density, you see here, this is the definition of the Legendre transform of the function. And then if you further functional derive this expression, like here, so you do a second functional derivative with respect to V, you get at the right-hand side a response function. You see it's the functional derivative of the density with respect to the variations. And this is the response function of the system, how the system, how the density of the system vary in response to a variation of the external potential. So this is a polarizability of the system. And this quantity, if all the quantities are defined on the real time, it should be a causal quantity. The polarizability should be zero for any T prime greater than T. So the system cannot respond to a variation which apply in future. Okay? So in this quantity is, should, you see, is a causal quantity, should be zero for T greater than T. But on the left hand side of the equation, you have a quantity which is symmetric. See, it's symmetric. So it cannot be zero if you do this this inversion. Again, this is a problem that has been solved by looking at the fact that TDFT is an out of equilibrium theory. So it's whenever you switch on a certain perturbation, you bring the system out of equilibrium. It means that the distribution of electrons are not anymore under Fermi-Dirac, for example, distribution. And you have to define TDFT like out of equilibrium theories, like Green's function, non-equilibrium Green's function theory. So, for example, a solution of the problem is to declare all these quantities of the quantities, not on real time, but on the Keldysh contour, composed of two branches. If you do it, all the quantities are correctly on the Keldysh time are correctly symmetric. Then at the end of your calculation, you project to the real time, which means that any quantity should have the same value if the time is declared, if the Keldysh time is on this branch or the other branch. And that by doing this, you restore causality for the final quantities that you want to observe. Yes?
The Keldysh contour is one way to solve it, but also there was a paper from Vignali of 2008, which is another way, but then you have to redefine your potential with a boundary term when you do the variation of your action with respect to your density. I always found it more simple than just
to Keldysh. No, I mean, it can be, for me, after I started this approach, for me, this is simpler. Okay. It's more elegant, but I agree that before to enter into this approach, you had to familiarize with this contour. There are other possibilities. There are other solutions, other point of view of this problem. For example, also the Gordon Bain was the first to take all this problem, and they did not introduce the Keldysh contour, and it also works with. Yes, you also have a question. I don't know.
Well, if you look for an extra difficult way to approach it, by far the worst that I found is the one introduced by Mukamel with this super operator, Liouville operator, which is very useful, but to solve this is a really complicated way. But another that was developed at the same time in which Robert Van Loren developed this Keldysh contour. So it was in the same time. And it was very, very difficult also.
However, to resume this part, so I put these two slides of caveats and further caveats because there are a lot of detractors of time-dependent density functional theory and also density functional theory that at a certain point can tell you, no, but the TDFT, I have heard that there are some problems. So for example, there is the symmetry causality problem or the fact that, that the functional is not defined for arbitrary variation of the density. All these problems have found a formal solution, mathematical solution. So the theory so far is on a ground basis. Okay, so don't care about this because these are people that are trying to diminish this theory are in principle exact and are exempt also so far of formal problems. And it's better I stop here for the coffee break. We are going to resume with TDFT in a response in half an hour.
Okay, please,
at 11. Okay.